Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's great to be with you this morning, and we have a great celebration planned. If you notice, our order of worship is a little bit different today. We found a bulletin that was dated back in 1916, and we are celebrating today with following the same format of worship. So, welcome. We'll do announcements a little bit later, and we're going to start off with our opening hymn. Number 57, Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Stand if you're so able. I want to extend our welcome to Marlene Richards, who is going to come forth now and lead us in the Apostles' Creed.
Please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.
Am I leaving?
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord God, we thank you for such a time as this. As many things have happened in this building over 100 years now, we thank you for the ministry that has happened here. We thank you that your name has been proclaimed many times. We thank you for all the United Methodist women meetings, the men's meetings, the youth groups, the children's studies, the youth choirs, the children's choirs. There's been so many things that this church has been a part of. And as we look backwards, we thank you for the many people that have been involved in those ministries, the many pastors, the many lay people that have done incredible things. We thank you, Lord God, for such a time as this. And we want to lift up those in our congregation that were not able to be here this morning. We want to pray for those who are sick, who are homebound. We just pray, Lord, that you would give them a blessing today. We pray for those in our community that are struggling with their health as well. I specifically want to lift up a gentleman named Jim this morning who is having some problems with his heart. We also want to pray for those who are going to be having surgery and procedures this coming week. We lift them up to you. We also want to pray for those in our world and our community that are struggling with issues of violence. We specifically want to lift up New York today as they have had another situation there. And Lord, we want to pray for those that are struggling with financial issues, emotional issues, spiritual issues, and physical issues that we may not even know this morning. And Lord, we want to lift up our families. And lastly, Lord, we pray for ourselves. And we ask for forgiveness for the things that we have done that have caused you grief this week. And we celebrate the way that you are working in our life, within and through us, with your Spirit. Continue to guide us as a church and as people that follow you, as you have done so well throughout the years. And we remember the things that have happened, and we also remember today the way that you have taught us how to pray. And we pray that prayer saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's welcome our choir this morning with their anthem.
God so loved the world. Good morning. Thank you for inviting us to your celebration here today. Vicki and I are honored to be here with you. I ask you now to turn to, in the back of your hymnals, to 741, or I imagine it might be on the screen also. We're going to do a Psalter from Psalm 4, and I'm praying that Jeremy and the choir lead us in our response, because you remember how I sing. Are we doing the response? 741? Let's try that again, and this time all of us are going to join with them. Answer me when I call, O God of my right. How long, O people, shall my honor suffer shame?
How long will you love vain words and seek after lies?
But you know that the Lord has set apart the righteous as God's own.
The Lord hears when I call.
But do not sin.
Commune with your own hearts and your beds, and be silent.
Offer right sacrifices.
And put your trust in the Lord.
There are many who say, oh, that we might see some good.
Lift up the light of your countenance upon us, O Lord.
You have put more joy in my heart than they have when their grain and wine abound.
In peace I will love.
Sound good this morning, congregation. It's great to hear you singing this morning like that. I just want to welcome you all here and draw your attention to some of the things that we're doing here in the church. First off, if you have not had a chance, How we take our attendance is on this slip of paper that's found in your bulletin. If you could fill that out with your name and address, and you'll see a lot of the different things that are happening in the life of the church on this page. It is our 100th celebration today. We have invited some folks back. I waited till now to introduce them to you. We had Marlene Richards, who did our Apostles' Creed, and her husband was Don Richards, and he served here from 1991 to 1994. We also had my predecessor, who did our Psalter this morning with us. His name is Rick Harry. He was here from 2005 to 2011. We also have, to do our benediction, Sammy Knappenberger, or Harold Sammy Knappenberger. And he was here actually when they built the education wing back in the 60s. And he was one of the two pastors with the longer tenure here at the church. Reverend McKnight and Reverend Knappenberger both have been here 10 years. I am working on year number 6 already, but they have been here the longest. So we welcome those folks here. It would have been nice to have all our pastors that have ever been here, but that is not possible. And we have also very many people who have worked on staff here. Also, we have music directors. We have our secretary here today and our maintenance person here as well. Deb and Lisa are here. But there have been many secretaries. Norma Sanford was our secretary for a while, and she's here with us. So there's been many people who have done many things here in the life of the church. Marlene Richards is the wife of Pastor Don Richards. She also did the Bells ministry here for many years, and her daughter is going to be, Don's daughter is going to be celebrating in music in just a few minutes with our offertory. So we welcome all those who are visiting with us and all those who have come back to celebrate with us on this 100th year of being in this building. A couple years ago, we celebrated the cornerstone laying down in 2014, and then here in 2016, this is when we first arrived in this building. I wish I could hear all the countless stories of the ministries that have happened in those 100 years. Also, just to give you some heads up on some things that are coming up, we have our supper club that is happening here on this coming Saturday, September 24th. We're going to be going to Benjamin's Roadhouse. If you had not signed up, please sign up in the back. We also have the Bible study, the follow Bible study, that is happening here on Thursday mornings. You're more than welcome to come. We started it last week, but you're more than welcome to come. We'd love to have you be a part of it. We have the Spark Worship, which will happen next Sunday night, a week from tonight, in the evening, our contemporary service. There's also a thanks in your bulletin. You'll want to look at that for all the people that have participated and got this celebration for us ready. Wanted to invite you to go downstairs. It says it's in the Aldersgate, but it will be downstairs for a luncheon that will follow immediately, and everybody here is invited. Now, is there any other announcements that I am failing to? One I know that I forgot. I just want to let you know that the United Methodist Women, sad but true, they have gone nutty once again. So they are collecting orders for the nut orders that they usually raise their funds with and do a lot of different fun things with in the church. So let's turn it back over to Reverend Robert Hernan. Let me introduce him to you today. He is somebody that has come out of this church. He grew up in this church. His mom is and dad are here with us, and his aunt and many other relatives, I think, are here. He grew up in this church, was ordained in 2001, am I right? He is serving in Smethport, Pennsylvania, which is pretty close to where I used to be before I came here in Johnsonburg. So we're excited to have him back. I think this is the first time you've preached in your home church before, is that right?
More or less.
So he's going to read us our scripture, and then we'll have our offertory. Welcome, Rob.
Matthew, the 6th chapter. And I'll be skipping around just a little bit. Listen now for the word of God. Jesus is speaking and says, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them. For then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogue and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's prepare our hearts for the morning offering.
Thank you.
God, as we receive this offering today, we think of the many folks that have come before you giving to this church, and we thank you for that. But we thank you for this offering specifically today, and we pray that it would be one that we can use to communicate the kingdom to our world around us. And we thank you for that opportunity, and we ask for a blessing upon it. And we pray this in your name. Amen. If the kids want to come forward, we can sit over here today. Why don't we sit on this pew right here? Hi, guys. I brought some things with me today. Actually, I need to go get one. I'll be right back. How many of you guys know what this is? What is it? It's a cell phone. And this is how many of us make a phone call. Do you know how you make a phone call on this? Can anybody make a phone call on this? You probably all can, you know? So as we're thinking about 100th year, this building, you know, is 100 years old. I was thinking about some things that have changed over the 100 years. And you know, this is actually a phone that I remember when I was a little kid. Does anybody know how to make a phone call? Where's the touch screen on it? Can you find the touch screen on it? You know how to do it? Come on up and show me. There's this thing called a rotary dial. Yeah, it's that way. Yeah, it's pretty cool. If you look at this, when we wanted to make a phone call, you had to take, if your number was 432-8961, you'd have to go 4-3. It took us forever to make a phone call. Does anybody remember the rotary dials? Yeah, yeah. And you know what? Another thing that it had on here was it was plugged into the wall, and it had this thing called a cord. And then we had to stay right here if we were going to make a phone call. We couldn't walk all over the house. And you know what? You had to be careful because sometimes you could really tangle yourself up and you could probably choke yourself with it. But you had to be careful with it. But that's how you made a phone call. You'd call somebody on the phone on a rotary dial phone. And we had this thing when I was growing up called a party line, which meant someone down the street shared our phone too. And we had this lady that would always get on our phone and said, I need to use the phone right now. So does anybody else remember party lines? Yes. Okay, and you know what? Then they had this thing that came out called Touchtone. I remember my aunt getting one of these when I was a kid. And you know, the coolest thing about it was we didn't have to dial anymore. We could push the buttons and call the numbers. And you know what the coolest thing, though, about these is it made music. And so you'd push this thing and it'd go beep, 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 beep when you'd call. And we thought that was the coolest thing in the world. You know, and now we can call people pretty fast and it would call. So the phones have changed. We went from rotary dial to this, and then they started doing this thing called cordless phones, which you didn't have this phone cord anymore, and you could walk all over the house. And we thought that was pretty cool. They were huge when they first came out. And then they started doing these things called cell phones. And you know what has happened? My phone has now become smarter than me. Isn't that crazy? It can do anything like a computer can. Well, as I was thinking about these phones and how they have changed over the years, I thought about the church. You know, the church has changed somewhat too. You know, in 1916, they did not have screens up on the wall. They didn't even have such a thing called television. So that has kind of changed. If you look in our bulletin, there's some different facts about 1916 that maybe your folks can share with you. Like a new car in 1916 cost $360. So things have really changed in the church. But you know, the one thing that has not changed at all is from 1916 to 2016, we know that God loves us, that God sent his son for us, that Jesus loved us. Jesus called the little children unto himself. And you know what? 2016, he still does. So some things have not changed. God's love always remains the same for us, even though things have changed dramatically. Go ahead, tell me.
That big thing will fall on the ground and go like this.
It would fall on the ground if you walked around. So we got to remember that things have changed, our phones have changed, but God's love for us stays the same. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for loving us so much that you sent your son to die for us. We know that that fact never changes. We thank you for such things as cell phones and smartphones and all the things that go along with that. But we really want to thank you most of all today for your love. And we just pray this in your most blessed name. Amen. Thanks, folks. We'll see you later. Let's join together with the hymn, Love Divine, All Love Excelling, number 384. Stand if you're so able.
me tell you, only Jesus could get me to wear a scarf in the summertime.
Whew!
It is warm up there. I imagine it's warm down here too, but at least you got a little cross ventilation down here. I'd like to thank you all for inviting me to come join you for this amazing celebration. Have some family here. My whole family couldn't be here. My son has, he's sick, and so mom is staying home, and my daughter thinks she might be coming down with it, so. But my other daughter's here, and my mom, and grandmother, and aunts, and uncles, and dad, and cousins, and great time. Reverend Knappenberger is here. Back in 1967, he baptized me in this very church. And he said earlier when I spoke to him, he said, well, I guess it took. And so here I am to share a sermon with you, to share some teaching from the gospel of our Lord. And as I move into that time, I'd invite you to lift your hearts to God with me in prayer. O God of truth and wisdom, you have given all Holy Scripture to edify your people and equip them for every good work. Anoint us now by the Holy Spirit that we may find in these written words your living word for our lives. Through Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. Amen. That's the prayer for illumination that they'll be using up in Smethport today, too. So that'll be a little connection between the church I'm serving and the church that has served me. The scripture today that I chose comes from the Sermon on the Mount. And it's powerful scripture. If you've never read anything else in the Bible, please read the Sermon on the Mount. Go home today. Break out your Bibles, find those red letters, and read the Sermon on the Mount. It doesn't take very long. It's just three chapters. Jesus is teaching. He's teaching the people about how to be holy, about how to be righteous, about how to be the right sort of person, how to live their lives as followers of Jesus. And in this particular section, chapter 6, he lifts up three practices of holiness that were common in the church. And something funny happens here. Jesus criticizes the way that people were practicing those things. They were praying, they were fasting, they were giving alms, but they weren't doing it in the right spirit. They weren't doing it the right way. And Jesus was criticizing that. The unfortunate thing, though, is that because Jesus was criticizing the way that those people did those things, we've somehow gotten it into our heads that we're not supposed to do them at all. When in fact, Jesus says, right up front, right straight out, when you give alms, when you pray, when you fast. He says, now don't do it like this, like the hypocrites do. But he doesn't think for a minute that you're not going to give alms, you're not going to pray, and you're not going to fast. He assumes that you're going to do that. He just wants you to do that the right way, with the right understanding. These three things, giving alms, praying, and fasting, represent the foundations of righteousness. Jesus was worried, though, about self-righteousness, that you were giving to the poor so that everybody could see that you were giving to the poor. Hey, look at him. He's really nice. What a great guy, giving to the poor. People were praying so that everybody would know that they were praying. Ever been in one of those situations where somebody's praying and you know that they're praying? They use great big words. They use flowery language. They raise their voices up on high. And you know that they're praying. Maybe in the middle of a restaurant, or maybe in a hospital, or maybe on the street corner, but you know that they're praying. Oh, aren't they good, wonderful people? They're praying. Jesus tells, actually, it's kind of a funny story. It doesn't translate very well into English. But Jesus tells a funny story of people disfiguring their faces when they fast. Oh, I'm fasting today. I'm so hungry, so miserable. I'm fasting. Oh, what a holy guy. Look at him. He is so hungry. His face is all screwed up. He's grabbing his gut. Oh, what a holy man. He must be fasting like that. This is self-righteousness. This is righteousness drawing attention to yourself. What Jesus calls for is other righteousness. There's self-righteousness. Jesus wasn't a fan of that. But there's other righteousness. Let me tell you how other righteousness works. And let me tell you how deeply weaved into the very basic fiber of our being other righteousness is. The first practice that Jesus lifts up is giving alms. Now, what is giving alms? Well, very basically, in its very most limited form, it's given an offering, like you guys just did. Note that I was smart and sat up there, and they're not taking an offering from me. Very basically, that's giving alms. But more generally, more broadly, giving alms was given for a specific reason. Now, you know that some of the money that you put in that plate is going to go to pay the district superintendent, it's going to go to pay the pastor, it's going to go to the trustees to help take care of the building. And it's also going to go to ministries here and there around the world and take care of people. But alms were specifically for taking care of people, taking care of the poor. Human beings are made to take care of each other. Human beings are made to take care of each other. Turn. Not right now, you don't have to. But turn sometime to Genesis, to those first few chapters of Genesis, the creation of the world, the creation of humankind. And you'll read about the Garden of Eden. A river flows out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it divides and becomes four branches. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are also in that land. Good bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which flows east of Assyria, and the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man out of the garden and put it in Eden to keep it and till it. Now, Remember reading through Genesis? On the first day, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light, and God saw that it was good. God's seeing everything being good in the first chapter of Genesis. Do you know what the very first thing God sees that isn't good is? Well, he's put the man in the garden. But then the Lord God says, for the first time, it is not good. The Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner. The very first thing in all of creation that God decides is not good is that the human being in the garden is alone in the garden and needs a helper. And so the reason that there are 7 billion people on planet Earth instead of just one is because God knew that we needed help. That's the whole reason for all the other 7 billion people on this planet. We are here to help each other. Almsgiving is the sign of helping each other. But it's much more than that, isn't it? It's helping each other to live, helping each other to get along in the world, reaching out to those in need. We were created, all of us except Adam, were created to be helpers. And so the first thing that we need to grasp hold of if we're going to be other righteous is helping one another. The second thing that Jesus talks about is prayer. Now, you all know what prayer is, right? Prayer is talking to God. But you know, sometimes we don't talk to God very well. Sometimes we don't talk to God in a way that builds relationships. Imagine a husband and wife who are married. And they've been married for, 49 years. Husband and wife, they've been married for 49 years, and all the wife has done in 49 years is make honey-do lists. That's it. She's never said, "Hey, I love you." She's never said, "Hey, let's go out to dinner." Just every morning when the husband wakes up, there's a honey-do list. She just asks him to do stuff. Imagine a couple. They've been married, let's say, 49 years. And all the husband ever does is talk, 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 talk. Never lets his wife get a word in edgewise. He's the star of the show, the main character on the sitcom. How in the world is that relationship going to last 49 years? If all the wife ever does is leave honey-do lists, and all the husband ever does is talk, 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 and no one can get a word in edgewise, how is that relationship going to survive? How is it going to thrive? It isn't. It's not going to be a healthy relationship. But how many of us wake up every day or go to bed every night and leave God a honey-do list? Oh, God, take care of this. God, take care of that. God, watch over this person and that person. God, do something about the poor, do something about war, do something about this, do something about that. Here's your honey-do list, oh God. And we pray and pray and pray and never stop to listen. Let me go back to Genesis for a minute to what I think is the saddest story in the Bible. Adam and Eve have just had the forbidden fruit. And the scripture says, then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. Here's the really sad part. It actually kind of makes me well up a little bit every time I read it. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called out to the man and said, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." Up until this moment, Adam and Eve had been living in the garden in the presence of God, loving God, being with God, enjoying God, and now all of a sudden they're afraid. Now all of a sudden they are hiding themselves. Their relationship with God has changed from one of comfort and closeness, one of intimacy and love, to one of fear. And they've hid themselves. In the temple at Jerusalem, you only were allowed to go into the Holy of Holies once a year. Go into the presence of God in the Holy of Holies once a year. And only the high priest was allowed to go into the temple on one day out of the year. And they would tie a rope around the high priest. They tied a rope around him so in case he went into the Holy of Holies and God struck him dead, they'd be able to pull out the priest without having to go in themselves. That was the relationship that they had with God. We could see God, well, not see God, but we can, well, go into the presence of God once a year, but there's really only one person who's quite holy enough to do that, and we have to watch out for that guy. So we're going to tie a rope around him in case God strikes him dead. When Jesus is crucified, when Jesus dies on the cross, one of the little details in the scripture is that the curtain of the temple is torn. The curtain that curtains off the Holy of Holies. It's a sign of a change of relationship. You don't have to worry about tying a rope around yourself to go into the presence of God. That relationship has changed. We're back to that Garden of Eden relationship. That's what prayer is a sign of. Prayer is a sign of our intimate relationship with God. Prayer is living with God every moment of every day. You don't have to be bowing your head and folding your hands all the time, particularly if you're driving. You don't have to be using words, using phrases, using gestures to be at prayer. You need to be in the presence of God. You need to have come out from hiding in the bushes and stand in the presence of God. The second piece of other righteousness is being in a right relationship, a loving relationship, being comfortable in the presence of God. Jesus then talks about fasting, and fasting is a funny one. Fasting is a funny one. Already today at this church service, we've prayed. Already today at this church service, we've made an offering for the poor, but fasting is something that maybe we're not very used to. But there's a broader aspect of fasting. When one fasts, one becomes keenly aware of food. I would really like to eat. I'm going to go and have a snack. But wait, I'm fasting. You know, that food belongs to God. God has created everything. I'm just watching out for it. I'm just taking care of it. So today I'm dedicating that food to God to remind myself that that food belongs to God and not to me, and that I can't just have it whenever I want it. I have it by God's good pleasure. I have it through God's grace. As giving alms is a sign of taking care of one another, and praying a sign of being in the presence of God, fasting is a sign of taking care of the world, taking care of the gifts that God has given us. Not just the food in our cupboard, but the people in our lives. Not just the people in our lives, but the resources in our earth. Once again, I want to take you back to Genesis. I've actually read this part already, so you've had a bit of a preview. After God planted the garden, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may eat freely of every tree in the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat." God put the man in the garden. God put humans on this earth to tend it and keep it, to take care of the earth. On the sixth day, God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." Have dominion over the earth. The word dominion comes from the Latin dominus. Dominus means Lord. God says, treat the earth as the Lord would treat it. Yes, you are the lords of the earth, but I am the Lord. Treat the earth, the animals, the plants, the rivers, the streams, the air, the soil. Treat the earth as I would treat it. Take care of the world. That's the third part of other righteousness, taking care of the world. Helping each other, standing in the presence of God always, and taking care of the world. That's our agenda, brothers and sisters. That's what holiness, that's what righteousness, that's what discipleship is all about. Taking care of each other, standing in the presence of God, and watching over, tending to the world. John Wesley, as he was founding the Methodist movement, gave us three simple rules, as Bishop Reuben Job liked to call them. Do no harm. Do good. And stay in love with God. Wesley was very fancy and said, attend upon all the ordinances of God. But that's what he meant. Have a good relationship with God, a loving relationship with God. Do no harm and do good. Sound familiar? Don't harm this world. Do good for one another. Stand in the presence of God. Now, I was looking at the church records, and it said that this church land was set aside in 1916. Is that correct? But the building actually didn't come until later. In fact, I think I remember being here in, was it 2004, and we were celebrating, I think, the 200th anniversary of the first Methodist meeting in Franklin. And you know what they did at those Methodist meetings? They asked each other, are you doing harm? Are you doing good? Are you staying in love with God? Are you taking care of one another? Are you taking care of the world around you? Are you standing always in the presence of God? This is at the heart of who we are as people. This is at the heart of who we are as Christians. This is at the heart of who we are as Methodists. Other righteousness. It's a game changer if we can grab hold of it. Take care of each other. Let everybody in Franklin say, look at those Methodists down there on Liberty Street. See how they take care of each other? See how they help each other? Let everybody see that you take care of the world. Let everybody know when they walk into this sanctuary that they stand in the presence of God and they don't have to worry that they're going to be struck dead. I'll confess one little secret before I leave. I judge a congregation when I become a pastor or whenever I'm speaking at a church. I judge a congregation by how they sing the Gloria Patri. You didn't know that, did you? I am always disheartened when I look out and see this. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen, amen. Are we joyfully in the presence of God today? Amen. Are we joyfully in the presence of God? Are we helping one another? Are we taking care of the world? Then we're on the right path. Amen.
Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for this message, and we pray that we would be able to go forth with it, apply it to our lives. And Lord, as we move forward to the next 100 years in this building, we pray, Lord, that you would bring your Spirit down upon us, that you would lead us into new and exciting places, and that we would be able to share the word of Christ. We pray this in your name. Amen. Let's join together with our closing hymn.
Thank you. pastor, for the privilege of being here today. This is a very special time for all of us. And as I thought about being here today, I'm sure all the other pastors that have served the church the 100 years would also have many, many memories that come to mind. And people that may not be here, but have gone to the reward in heaven. I'm also glad that my brother, Reverend Liston Amphenberger, and his wife, Marilyn, can be here also with my wife, Elsie, today. Liston is retired United Methodist pastor, and he was a graduate of the high school here. The name, yeah. As I thought about some of the things that we have said and have heard today, I reminded of something that Dr. G.C. McCandless said to me when, and his son David is here today, Dr. McCandless. We had finished the plans for a new education unit. We'd had one time together to raise some money, and now we were waiting to get started. And I remember Dr. McCandless said to me, "When are you going to get going? Because I want to put this in, I want to put my brick in while I'm still here." And I wonder how many of us can remember the time that we put a brick in this building. The people who have gone before us, the pastors, and those that are here now. And that would be the challenge that I leave with you. We love thy church, O God. And as we go from this place, may we go with the Spirit of Christ within our hearts. I love thy church, O God. Her walls before me stand, engraven in thy hand. Let us pray. May the strength of a newfound morning, the peace of the eternal hills, and the living presence of Jesus Christ go with us as we are called to do our part, as we give thanks for what has been, and we look forward in faith to that which will be. This we ask in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.